So this is the session that is organized by the Fiqh Council of North America, and we have three speakers, myself, Muzammil, Siddiqi. I am serving as the chair of the Fiqh Council, and our executive director, Dr. Zulfiqar Shah. Then we have Dr. Jamal, Badawi, a member of the Fiqh Council. So three of us, inshallah, will be talking. And our topic is Shariah still relevant? We'll talk different aspects of Shariah, because this is a broad subject. We're only taking some few points on that, and briefly discussing that, and then we'll have time, inshallah, for questions and answers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Jasiyah, Surah number 45, ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيعَةٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْرِ فَاتَّبِعَهَا وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ إِنَّهُمْ لَنْ يُغْنُوا عَنْكَ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَإِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّ الْمُتَّقِينَ هذا بصائر للناس وهدى ورحمة لقوم يوقنون. Now we have set you on a clear path. The word Sharia is used for clear path. So follow it. Do not follow the desires of those who do not know. They cannot help you against Allah in any way. Wrongdoers only have each other to protect them. The righteous have Allah Himself as their protector. This revelation is a means of insight for people, a source of guidance, and mercy for those who are of sure faith. In America, there is this phenomena that is growing, and the phenomena is known as Islamophobia. And Islamophobia has many manifestations, and one of the manifestations of Islamophobia is Sharia phobia, the fear of phobia, the fear of Sharia. So it is said Sharia is cruel against human rights, against the rights of women, against the rights of minority. Sharia does not allow freedom of expression, freedom of religion. Sharia is a political and military doctrine of Islam and a threat to America and to human civilization. Some call the evil and extremist activities of ISIS, the so-called group that's called Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, they call it, this is real Islam, this is real Sharia. And then say that Muslims want to impose Sharia on the non-Muslims. It is obvious that most of this propaganda against the Sharia is done by people who either do not know much about Islam, about Sharia, or they are deliberately misrepresenting it for their own objectives and agenda. So we as Muslims must be very clear what Sharia is, so we can speak about these principles, these values. First of all, the word Sharia means a clear path. This is the way given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the ethical law of Allah for the human well-being. All prophets of Allah, all the messengers of Allah, they receive guidelines for their communities, how they should live. And these guidelines were called Sharia. Allah says in the Quran, Surah Ash-Shura, شَرَعَ لَكُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ وَمَا وَصَّيْنَا بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى. He set you on a path that is given also to Noah. You know, Noah alayhi salam, one of the very early prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Actually, some people call him a prehistoric prophet, and history was not even recorded. So Allah says, even from that time immemorial, Allah gave message. And then what we have given you, and we gave to Abraham, Moses, and Jesus, Ibrahim, Musa, and Isa, alayhi salam. Prophet Muhammad, being the last and the final prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his message is universal message. The law that was given to him is a universal law. But I want to emphasize the difference between universality and universalism. The message of Islam is universal. It is for all people, for the whole world. But it is not universalistic. That means it is not imperialistic. It is not hegemonic. It is not imposed upon those who do not believe in it. Because the Quran says very clearly, La ikraha fid din. There is no compulsion in the matter of religion. So yes, rules are universal, applicable in all times, in all places, and all people. But it is people's choice to accept them or not to accept them. No compulsion in the matter of religion. So Sharia is not a rigid system. It is not a closed system. It has both specific laws as well as general principles. Specific laws, of course, have to be followed. But as far as the general principles are concerned, on the basis of that, many laws can be made. So there is a difference between Sharia and Fiqh. Sharia is given by God, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Fiqh is the work of the human beings. On the principles laid down by the Quran and the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him. So fiqh is the understanding and interpretation of the rules and guidance of the Sharia by the scholars, by the knowledgeable people, and they differ in their interpretation. So you have mazahib, the schools of thought. The existence of the variety of schools, the mazahib, itself is an indication that Sharia is broad and open to interpretation. The objectives, the scholars emphasize that Sharia has certain objectives. And these objectives are derived from the basic values that are given in the Quran and the Sunnah. Imam Al-Juwayni, and then after that Imam Al-Ghazali, they spoke about the five basic values. We call them maqasid of Sharia. Sharia came to protect life and promote life. Sharia is to protect and promote reason, mind, intellect. Sharia is to protect and promote family, honor. And it is to protect and promote the property, the wealth, and it is for the protection and promotion of religion. Religious liberty, religious rights are also part of the Sharia. These are the classical objectives. Many scholars later and in modern time have added some more values of Sharia on the basis of the Quran and the Sunnah. For example, they talk about one of the values of Sharia is human dignity, freedom, individual's rights, peace and security, general welfare of the humanity. It is also emphasized as additional maqasid, additional objectives of Sharia. So this whole discussion shows that Sharia is a dynamic system, and it is for all human beings to study this system and use it for their benefit without getting into fear, prejudice and propaganda. Famous scholar of Islam, Ibn Qayyim, died in the year 1350. He emphasized these values. So he said the Sharia has four important values. He calls it Rahmah, Maslaha, Adl, and Hikmah. هي عدل كلها ورحمة كلها ومصالح كلها وحكمة كلها. Sharia is all together is عدل, justice, all together mercy, all together human benefits, and all together حكمة, wisdom. And then he says further, he said كل مسألة خرجت من العدل إلى الجور وعن الرحمة إلى ضدها وعن المصلحة إلى المفسدة وعن الحكمة إلى العبث فليست من الشريعة. If you find any rule by any interpretation that takes this Sharia from justice to injustice, from mercy to the opposite of mercy, and from maslaha, from the human benefit, to the mafsada, the corruption, and from hikmah, from the wisdom, to futility, it has nothing to do with Sharia, even if it is put into by interpretation of someone. Now, another thing that you have to understand is Sharia is not just right and wrong. Sharia classifies the rules in five categories, at least, according to most of the Jews. There is a category of fard, obligatory, mustahab, recommended, and then the category of haram, forbidden, and makruh, disliked, unrecommended, and then there is a general category called mubah, permissible, and your own choice. So, and furthermore, Sharia also gives us priority, which is what awlawiyat. It emphasizes that there are certain things called dururiyat, necessities, and then it's called hajat, further needs, and then tahsiniyat, furthermore, embellishment, luxuries, and all of these things, you can add that. So you have to have priorities. First thing is, emphasized is necessities of life. What is the most important thing for the survival of the people? Second thing is the people's need, and then after that you have other things you can add, extra. There are three important points that I want to mention briefly, because our time is very limited, so I want to mention briefly. Three points we must always keep in mind in Islamic, understanding Islamic philosophy. In Islam, human beings are considered body and soul. Our body is from the material of this earth. Our soul is from the divine breath. It has a divine origin. So we have both. Body has its needs, food, brings, that's family, and all of these things you have, body's needs. It is important to pay attention to these needs of the body. But then there is soul, and soul has its own needs. Prayers, fasting, charity, kindness, all of these things are principles that are related to spirituality. Of course, the spirituality has preference over the physicality, but both of them have to be kept in balance. إِنَّ لِجِسْمِ إِنَّ لِبَدَنِكَ جَسَدِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا وَإِنَّ لِعَيْنِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا وَإِنَّ لِذَوْرِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا. The Prophet ﷺ emphasized that. Your body has a right on you. Your eyes have a right on you. That means you have to take rest. Your visitors have rights on you. Your family has a right on you. All of these things, but at the same time emphasizing that you also understand there are the divine rights as well. So keep a balance between the two of them. Another thing that we have to remember, the Sharia emphasizes that we are individuals. Every person has his own individuality. But we are also community. We are all interconnected. No one is an island to himself or herself. Everybody is connected to his family, to his neighbor, to his city, to his town, to his country. The country is also connected to the globe. Everybody is interconnected. So there are certain duties and responsibilities. Yes, individuals have their rights, but at the same time also their rights of the people. And we have to live in such a way that keep a balance between individuality and also the society. The third thing that emphasizes in the philosophy of Islam is the life has two aspects. Life here and life hereafter. It is not only life here. Yes, we are here, but we are not here forever. And we are going to leave. And this whole world is going to leave. This whole world is going to come to an end. But this is not the end. The life has two aspects. Life here and life hereafter. So there is eternal world. So what we have to do, we have to keep in mind both this life, the needs of this life, and the life to come, the eternal life. وَابْتَغِهِ مَا أَتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Seek the life to come. The realities of the life to come, the blessings of the life to come, seek for that. Don't forget the fair share of this world. Keep a balance between the two of them. So this is the general understanding. Then of course, as far as extremism is concerned, it's extremism condemned in Islam. Extremism is against the nature of Islam. The Quran says, لا تقتلوا النفس التي حرم الله إلا بالحق. Do not kill any soul. Unless it is in the pursuit of justice. وَمَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ وَفَسَادٍ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. If anyone kills a person, one person, without any reason, as if he has killed the whole humanity. وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Taking care of one person is like taking care of the whole humanity. And our Prophet, peace be upon him, said, الْمُؤْمِنُ مَنْ يَأْمَنُهُ النَّاسِ. The real believer is the person who people trust. فِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنْفُسِهِمْ. With their wealth and with their persons. Wallahi la yu'min, wallahi la yu'min, wallahi la yu'min. The Prophet said 3 times. By God, he is not a believer. By God, he is not a believer. By God, he is not a believer. The Sahaba said, who is that person, Ya Rasulullah? قَالَ مَنْ لَا يَأْمَنُ جَارُهُ غَائِقًا. The one whose neighbors are not safe from his troubles. Good neighbors. And regardless, who are your neighbors? Muslim, people of other faith, anybody. You have to be good to your neighbors. And then he emphasized, وَعِسْتُ لَوْتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I am sent by God to fulfill the best, the noblest of ethics and morals and characters. So Islam created the most tolerant culture. When people practice Islam, the culture is very tolerant. And the civilization is a tolerant civilization that people live and let live. The extremist groups today, they do not represent Islam. Actually, they misrepresent Islam. They are enemies of Islam. And the enemies of against the noble teachings of Sharia. They misrepresent Islam due to ignorance, due to self-interest, and also anger and grievances. And there is a long history of grievances in the Muslim world. Because of the political fragmentation, foreign domination, colonialism, exploitation from within and from outside. This is all going on, but in spite of that, most Muslims are against extremism. If you read a very good book that was done by visiting 35 Muslim countries and having extensive interviews and surveys and polling the opinions of the people, this was done by our sister Dalia Mujahid. The book is called Who Speaks for Islam? What a billion Muslims really think. Overwhelming majority of the Muslims are totally against extremist thinking, extremist idea. They are for tolerance, for living together, for peace, for justice, for fairness, for democracy, for good relations between East and West, all of this. And then Islamic scholars, our Fiqh Council of North America, we have issued many statements against extremism, especially violent extremism. So Fiqh Council issued a fatwa long time ago on this subject of extremism, against Islam condemns extremism. 150 Muslim scholars of different schools of thought from all over the world, they issued a statement that is available online called A Common Word Between Muslims and Christians. how Muslims and Christians can live together. 126 Muslim scholars from around the world of different schools of thought, they issued a fatwa, very long fatwa, 28 page long, against ISIS, so-called Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. And they called it its practices un-Islamic, and its claim of Islamic State and Caliphate bogus and absurd, and against the noble teachings of Islam. Our organization, Fiqh Council of North America, is a signatory on this statement among 126 scholars. And I had the honor to present that statement at the National Press Club last September 2014. So this is our position, and that is what Sharia is all about. We hope and pray that people have better understanding and understand what we are saying, what Muslims are saying, and there is it's totally wrong to create prejudice, propaganda against any group of people. Thank you.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We have an apology and responsible for that. In fact, I have been so consumed since Fajr preparing a power presentation that might facilitate the presentation, but it is my fault actually that I couldn't make advance arrangement for that. The title of this sub-part of this session I give is rebuttal of extremist justification of brutalities. In fact, I had something else in mind, but when I read carefully the description of the of this session, I decided to shift it a little bit, so I have to work for 4 or 5 hours to get it in some shape. So forgive me if I speak relatively fast, but not really awfully fast, without the benefit of PowerPoint. To start with, to give you an idea, I have 6 areas to cover in perhaps 15 to 17 minutes. I try my best. 1, extremism. What does it mean, and what is the scope of extremism? 2, an Islamic view on extremism. 3, rules of sound interpretation of Islamic texts, which is the source of lots of problems. Number four, some serious misinterpretations. 5, 6 is how to fight extremism, and finally where to go from here. It would be quite heroic if all of that can be covered, and ready to eliminate some parts that are not as essential. To start with, what is extremism? Well, if you look at dictionary definition, it is the quality or state or habit of going to extremes in views and or action. Somebody could be extreme in his thinking, but is not violent for that matter. And to say that he would be promoted automatically, that's not quite true. The scope, when we speak about extremism, we should not only focus on religious extremism. There is political extremism, there is social extremism. And in fact, with respect to religious extremism, all major religions have their own extremist and or violent fringes. We speak about history in the past, you can find many examples, or even at present. Sometimes you get a very potent and problematic mix between religious extremism and political extremism. Far right, sometimes there are a very disturbing combinations. The second question, with this general definitions, what is a Muslim view of that, and I never used the term for matter of ijtihad, the Islamic viewpoint or perspective. I think we should be more humble. I say an Islamic criticism or Islamic view of extremism. You judge it for yourself. The closest Quranic term to extremism that appear in the Quran and Hadith is ghulu. And in both sources, extremism or ghulu is soundly condemned. There is a crucial verse in the Quran, that's verse 143 in the second chapter of the Quran or Surah. I'll just give you the translation meaning because of time. And thus, we, means Allah, have made you a justly balanced ummah. That's the best translation of wasat. Justly balanced ummah to be witnesses for Allah to people and the messenger, meaning Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a witness for Allah to you. When we speak about justly balanced, that balance is not defined according to one's own whims, but it is defined according or as defined by Sharia, as Dr. Muzammil indicated, its supreme objectives, spirit, and guidelines. So it is quite clear then we conclude from a Quranic and Hadithic perspective, extremism is to be rejected, and whether you call it moderation or just balance is what Islam really emphasizes. I'll come to a tacky area, but very quickly, because that's a topic by itself. In my humble view, many of the very dangerous interpretation made of the Quran, aside from other personal agendas or politics of it or anything, I'm just focusing on the issue of hermeneutics in itself, is a result of very mistaken interpretation of the human text and the way Islamic interpretation are made from these sources. One is to emphasize that the ultimate sources for Muslims is not what this scholar or that scholar said, what this practice of Muslim rulers in the past or present are doing. The ultimate references is revelatory source for Muslim for any interpretation to be made. And they are in that order of importance, the Quran, which is verbatim, according to Muslim word of Allah, and the sound or authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So again, I'm emphasizing, it is not the practices of Muslim or opinion of scholars under certain circumstances or situation that is the final. Everything has to go back to the Quran and hadith if you can make a sound argument using proper and sound hermeneutical methods. There are three areas. The hermeneutics itself could be a whole issue from the soul level. Lots of things that we said, but I'm just trying to simplify because of time on three major areas. One, there are problems and issues sometimes for those who interpret the Quran or Hadith with respect to the language. Worst of that, of course, is to depend totally on translation of the meaning of the Quran in other languages where sometimes it is totally off, and maybe we'll see some examples as we go on. But even for Arabic speaking, even if you look at the Arabic lexicon, you find that sometimes there are several meanings of the same term, so it must be not only accurate lexically, but also contextual, because it's used in the different contexts in the Quran. Second, a very important one, I call it textual context. Many of the scholars of sciences of the Quran, ulum al-Quran, call it the rule of al-Quran yufassiru ba'duhu ba'dan, Quran explaining itself. Because the Quran is not divided by subject or chronology, it has unique order, which means that you have to understand fully the entire Quran to be able to cull together all of the references that relate to one subject rather than sticking, putting your teeth in one text selectively, cherry picking, and just focus on that one or a few. All text has to be brought together, not only in the Quran, because Hadith also is explanatory of the Quran, so they have to collect also sound Hadith that relate to the same topic. This is a very, very important one. Thirdly, the historical context, which may include really two elements. One is what the scholars of the science of the Quran call the asbab al-nuzul, or the occasion of revelation of certain ayahs in the Quran, which may shed light on its true meaning. But I mean also by historical context something wider, which is not technically exclusively asbab al-nuzul or occasion of revelation, but the historical context of the society in which the Quran was revealed. How did they understood things? What was the existential threats that faced them? So I put it together, but because both relate to history anyway, and there are many others that time does not allow. And now I move to the fourth item, serious misinterpretations. I'll give only five examples, but allow me to cover them in just a little bit of depth, rather than just speak without anybody picking anything up. The first myth, that the Quran teaches Muslims to kill non-Muslims wherever they find them. The famous ayah, chapter 9, verse 5. And most often, even it is not quoted in full or accurately translated or explained. Because what is normally killed, if I take a variety of Islamophobic statements, many would just quote this, kill the non-Muslims, but by the way, this is not the term in the Quran. Kill the non-Muslim, sometimes people volunteer and add between brackets, including Jews and Christians. Wherever you find them, seize them and besiege them and prepare for them in each ambush. And they say, is this really that you give us headache? Islam is the religion of peace. Islam is peace. Islam is peace. And all of this, is it not violence really that is really rooted in the Quran, or how else do you explain your own book that you believe in? A number of points to say very quickly. One, I put it in a form of question. What was the beginning of the verse? Because the verse does not begin by kill. It says, and when the sacred month has passed. Why some people eliminate that is rather interesting, because any person who's not familiar with the Quran or history, life of the Prophet, you might say, what does that sacred month? And then they may discover the mistaken interpretation that they try to thrust on people. So that's one. B, when the Quran, even if some people who quote even the beginning of the part of the ayah, when the sacred months are, that means you're giving even a period of 4 months, because the sacred months are four. It's three in sequence and one different. So if indeed the Quran teaches bloodthirst and killing the non-believer, you're giving them 4 months advance notice that if they change their ways, then there's nothing that will happen to them. 4 months, which is a good thing, by the way, that Islam accepted, which was there before Islam, to stop war for 1/3 of the year. No fighting in this 4 months. Why wait? Just go and kill them wherever you find them. And then the translation. Are all non-Muslims included? Are Jews and Christians included? That goes to what I call also language issues. The exact term, Arabic term in the Quran used is not people of the book, which refer to Jews and Christians. It is not non-Muslims or kuffar, which is a broader term, those who are, chose not to accept Islam. But al-mushrikeen, a term that was never used in the entire Quran as a title of people in the book. So who entered Jews and Christians and explained all the 9/11 and all of that stuff, because the Quran teaches hatred for Jews and Christians. What it refers to then is actually in the context of the Quran, in the context of the setting, historical setting, it means only the idolatrous Arabs, not all over the world, the idolatrous Arabs in Mecca and the surrounding area. But why even find those? In fact, if you read carefully, and that's again the importance of textual context, read from verse 1 to 14, you find that there are two verses, namely 4 and 7, that specify that those idolatrous Arabs who did not, and I'll come to that history, betray their treaty with the Prophet ﷺ, are exempt. So there are two references to that. So it's not even all pagans, not even all pagans in Arabia. What is it referring to then that leads us to come to the other issue of historical context? It is not to be generalized, this ayah. Why? Basically, the idolatrous Arabs had a peace treaty with the Prophet ﷺ. I'd love to speak about it, but I cut short because of time. But basically, to stop all hostility and to have peace between the Muslims and their adversaries, especially under the leadership of the powerful tribe of Quraysh, which is the tribe of the Prophet that gave him really hard time. In return for that, they were giving so many concessions. All the Prophet wanted was to have peaceful relationship, freedom, exchange of ideas and trade and everything. That treaty was supposed to be for 10 years, but about a year and a half or so, more people entered into the fold of Islam than those who accepted Islam maybe more than 15 years ago, which shows again Islam doesn't spread by the sword or power or intimidation or compulsion, but by the free exchange of ideas. And throughout history, you will find that in the worst of times that the Ummah, the Muslim community passed through, they were beaten and still Islam continued to spread. Now, with that kind of breaking, it was not a very small thing that they did, because they attacked people in the side of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and killed people cold-bloodedly. What do you call that in modern terms? War crime. Simple and pure. We have the treaty. Muslims never betrayed any part of the treaty. Just the Prophet was very careful about that. And then they come and kill the innocent people. So the ayah is only applicable to those cold-blooded murderers. We can't handle them with kids' glove. Then you find further evidence in the section still from 1 to 13 or 1 to 14. And I quote from verse 13, for example. Will you not fight people who violated their oath, i.e. their treaty, violated their oath, plotted to expel the messenger, and were the first to start aggression against you? In verse 10, they respect no ties, neither the ties of kinship or covenant, again, allusion to the breaking of the treaty of Hudaybiyah. It is they who are the transgressors. I hope with that clarification, that issue should really fairly be put to rest. The second one was covered, I think, in another convention, maybe last year or year before, but I go through it very fast also, but it is crucial. Because oftentimes the media call all brutal actions as part of jihad. And we had this very amazing innovation, violent jihad. That's a big mix-up. And they say the Quran preaches holy war. One, holy war is a term that never appeared in the Quran anywhere. Two, the term is self-contradictory. There is nothing holy about war, death, destruction, and human suffering. Three, jihad has nothing to do with holy war or terrorism, because the way in English, the word holy war, it means, is defined, it is a war waged by one religion against the other religion, which is the only reason that you believe they have the false religion. There is no such expression or allusion even to that. The term jihad comes from the origin in Arabic, J-H-D, or Arabic, J-H-A, which actually means to exert effort, maximum effort. In fact, if one look at the usage of the term jihad and variety of derivatives, both in the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, we find that most forms are non-combative. One form is the non-combative jihad, where the term has been used, referred to inner purification. One, to explain the truth, to explain the truth to people. They say the Quran is that tool for that jihad, meaning intellectual jihad. There is financial jihad, meaning charity. There is political jihad, opposing, even peacefully, the rulers who are tyrannical. Women's pilgrimage was regarded also as form of jihad, which means that each and every one, Muslim, non-Muslim, everyone is engaged in jihad if you're really striving to do something good, whether we're a Muslim or not. The only exception to the non-combative is the combative jihad, which is allowed in the Quran only to resist aggression and oppression, and I have a list of number of ayat in the Quran, it's not just coming off the cuff. And only to be resorted to the force. If peaceful means fail, and there are evidence for that as well. Thirdly, that even if war breaks and peaceful settlements, just peaceful settlements were not possible, and there was any gesture on the part of the aggressors, وَإِنْ جَنَحُ لِسَنِ we should also, addressing the Prophet, you should be also inclined to peace, because the idea is not just getting into war and bloodshed. In addition to very, very strict rules to protect non-combatants, do not kill or injure, do not finish an injured person, mutilate the dead, torture prisoners of war or pillage, and what horrors you hear about attributed in the name of Islam, violate every single word of the hadith of the Prophet and every mention in the Quran in word or spirit. As I love to put it, the idea is winning as many hearts as possible, not cutting or severing as many heads as possible. A third myth, the Quran teaches Muslims to be hostile to non-Muslims in general, and specifically to people of the book, also in some verses, people, Jews or Christians. Again, go back, remember the language issues here. The Quran doesn't say don't take Jews and Christians friends, because the Arabic term for friends is astiqa, but the Quran didn't use that. It said awliya, and the term awliya is more than friendship, actually in that context, meaning as your defenders or allies. But even then, if you look at the ayat that forbade that alliance, it appeared in three negative situations. One, don't take them as allies instead of Muslims. That's not offensive to anyone. A second one, as an act of hypocrisy in wartime. There's a story about that. That was his communication of information about, you know, planned a campaign by the Prophet so that he can gain favor with the people in Mecca, because he has some relatives there. Or, as the Quran said in the ayah that's most quoted as indication of the hostility, that ayah speaks, those who take your religion for mockery, and when you call for the prayer, they mock at you. So they are all negative situations, but one ayah actually opened the door for alliance, if indeed it is beneficial for the security of all. إِلَّا أَن تَتَّقُوا مِنْهُمْ تُقَى. I'll go very quickly now. The general context also, the textual context, is not only that they take part of an ayat, cherry pick, but also neglect to examine other ayat in the Quran about the normative relationship between Muslims and others. I'll just give you the ayah number. The surah is number 60, ayah 8 and 9, that basically says that if anyone, not only Jews and Christians, coexist peacefully with you and refrain from committing aggression or oppression against you, you should deal with them in respect, kindness. Even more than that, if I have time, I could elaborate about the precision of the specific terms used in the Quran. There's no problem at all in that respect. So hatred due to faith is alien to true teaching of Islam. The same thing applies when people say, but the Quran speaks about fighting the people of the book also. But that's contextual also, because there were some people of the book in the early days of Islam who killed the memorizers of the Quran that were sent by the Prophet to other tribes. Some were gathering armies, so it was not all the people of the book that would contradict the norm, but only those who represented a serious threat to Muslims. The final one, Muslims must prevail over others. And some people add something which is not in the Quran, meaning that there will be no other religion than Islam, which is nonsense, really. What the Quran speaks about the right of minorities, respect of the people of the book who are coexisting peacefully, and you say that, you know, they should be wiped out. There are all the rules of the rights of people of the book and non-Muslims in general. abath yani. But the word yuzhirahu in Arabic here was translated best by Abdullah Yusuf Ali, that not to prevail as such, but to proclaim from zuhur. And whether he interpreted this way or that way, that promise is not for Muslims as people, but for Islam, even if Muslims are defeated. And prevailing also does not have to be violent. If in a debate, somebody A prevailed over B because he had a more cogent argument, this is also prevailing. It doesn't have to be in a historical. How to fight extremism? One, mitigate external partial causes. I'm using careful terms. I have no time to elaborate. External partial causes of extremism, such as injustice, discrimination, disrespect of human dignity, hate, various forms of phobia, campaigns, and stereotypes, by all sides. Secondly, to educate all, again, Muslims and their friends from other faith communities. Three, we have to have a self-purification, to be mindful of Allah and the principle that Dr. Muzammil elaborated on, that Sharia in reality is mercy, is justice, is wisdom. There is none of these in the brutal act that is falsely committed in the name of Islam. Then we have to share this knowledge with others, because not everybody is hostile from nothing. It is basically because lack of information. Where to go from here finally to pursue peace, harmony, and unity? To have the right humble attitude and fairness, not pointing finger always to others. All did wrong, we have to admit that. To reach out to one another, have mutual understanding and respect, finding the area of commonality, capitalize on them, understand respectfully the area of differences without polemics, to connect between justice and peace, and to work together for things of common cause, such as health care, caring of the poor. This is the real, practical, down-to-earth dialogue. Thank you very much. My apologies, I think I might have taken a few seconds.
Thank you. Alhamdulillah, as-salatu was-salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsani ila yawm al-deen. Amma ba'd, fa'auzu billahi min ash-shaytan al-rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. In conclusion, I just want to share some of the thoughts with you about the subject. It used to be that Islam in itself is the religion of peace. The Quran does not breed violence. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a prophet of goodness. But now it has come to the period where Quran itself becomes the problem. Where Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is portrayed as the maniac, na'uzubillah min zalik. And the Sharia is explained as the source of uncivilized barbaric activities in the world. So therefore we have to understand, it is not the issue of just Sharia, whether Sharia is divine or not, relevant or not, it has become an issue between Islam and non-Islamic belief system. And I will go even further than that. There is a struggle between what we call secularism, atheism, agnosticism, and what is called religiosity. So among the people who are secular, they have seen the development from the ancient time to the medieval time to modernity. They say that in the ancient time, the kings ruled in the name of God, in the name of divinity. They said, we are the shadow of God, so in the name of divine right, they promulgated the laws and did not allow anybody to challenge those laws. In the medieval time, the church shared, or the religious or clerical establishments, they shared the authority with the kings. So the kings and the princes will rule the civil areas, and the religious people will rule in the name of God, what we call Sharia, or canon law, or the Jewish law. but because these clerical establishment or religious establishment really abused their power. And in the name of God and in the name of Sharia or law, they basically abused everybody. So in the West, when people stood up, they said, no more of this kind of law, no more of this religious Sharia, no more of this religious abuse. We believe in humanism. Man is independent, man is dignified, and man can chart out his or her own discourse. We do not need somebody to come and tell us what to do and what not to do. So therefore, they have reached to the conclusion that religiosity itself, or religious laws themselves, or religious sacred books themselves are nothing but tools of humanizing the masses and controlling the masses. That's where you hear Marx saying, religious is nothing but the opium of the people. That's where you hear many of the people saying, we are living in modern times and we do not want to go to the ancient or medieval barbaric laws. Same thing is in their mind when they talk about Islam and when they talk about Islamic Sharia. They cannot believe that something can be from God directly or could be based upon divine justice, because they don't believe there is something called divine. They don't believe there is something called soul or spiritual realms. They don't believe there is something beyond this world or this material utilitarian sphere. So therefore you have to understand that we Muslims are the last resort for that group of people who, in the name of democracy, capitalism, in the name of modernity, want to hegemonize the world and want the world to submit to them. It's only the Muslims, in the name of the Quran, in the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the name of Islamic Sharia, are still resisting. If you look into what Gellner said, Ernest Gellner, one of the most renowned sociologists, British sociologists, he said, if you look at the medieval time, say even 16th century, there are four civilizations which were controlling the world at that time. The Judeo-Christian, which were basically the successors of Roman Empire or Byzantine Empire. The Chinese, all of those Mongols and Afghanate, you name it. The Indians, or whatever you call it, the Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, that kind of, and Islamic civilization. He says, look at that, all three of them, the Hindu civilization or Indian civilization, the Chinese civilization, and also the Judeo-Christian civilization have been secularized. 90%, according to them, of the even Judeo-Christian background people don't consider that canon law has got anything to do with God. Majority of them do not believe that Bible, whether Old Testament or New Testament, can clearly be called the Word of God. Nobody believes in Hinduism that Bhagavad Gita or any of the books of Buddhism are from God. And Chinese have become what? Basically, Marxist in the beginning, and then you can call the communist. Here in the West, it's not Christianity or Judaism which is the power or the norm. It is the secular power, it's man-made laws. So therefore, he says there's only one exception, which is Islam and Islamic civilization. And the base of that, he says, is that they believe that Quran is the word of God, it's terminal, and Sharia is the canon law which cannot be violated. So what you are seeing right now, they have reached to this conclusion that to really attack the Muslim world and make them submit to us and not resist to our colonial or hegemonic powers, basically they have to give up this concept of Quran as the word of God, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the model, as the uswa, and Sharia as the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, remember, it's not an issue of the relevance of Sharia. This is the issue of Islam and non-Islam, number one. Number two, coming back to what is Sharia and whether or not it is relevant to our time. Remember one thing, Sharia is not what we understand nowadays, just the law of Islam. The entire religion of Islam is Sharia. لِكُلِّنْ جَعَلْنَا مِنْكُمْ شِرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا. And when Dr. Muzammil recited the verse from Surah Al-Jasiyah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet والسلام, as if he knew what was going to be happening after 14 centuries. ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيَةِ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ فَاتَّبِعَ وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. After trying this Sharia during the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim, Sayyidina Musa, Sayyidina Isa, and all the prophets, after testing it out for centuries, we gave you this good product to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيَةٍ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ فَاتَّبِعَ. So follow this good product, this divine product. وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. And do not follow the desires of those people who do not know. So basically what we are seeing right now, those people who do not know the basics of religion, who do not have any concept of divine being or spirituality or morality, whose lifestyle is basically revolving around materialism, hedonism, instantaneous gratification, they cannot see why people compromise or why people do not compromise on several issues. The issue is, for us, it's totally different. It's totally different worldview. We believe that Quran is the word of Allah. We believe that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had that connection where he can tell us what is going to be happening after death, where is Jannah and where is Jahannam, and what do we need to do to accomplish, to become good people in the way of Allah and attain that Jannah. That concept is totally different. So therefore, remember one thing. For us, Sharia is Islamic morality, Islamic aqidah, Islamic akhlaq and ethics, Islamic political system, economic system, social system. The entire religion of Islam, the essence of Islam is Islamic Sharia. Now also in Islam, Sharia is also what we call, as Dr. Muzammil and Dr. Jamal explained, that the fiqh very often is called Sharia. And very often when those people want to quote what they call barbaric activities and barbaric principles, they quote different fatwas of different jurists from the books of fiqh. For example, when they are quoting about ISIS, and the ISIS will bring some of the quotes from Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayh, or Ibn Kathir, or Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, basically what happens, they say, see, this is what is Sharia. And here I want to really make very clear that the fiqh, as Dr. Muzammil said, is the production of Muslims, scholars who are human beings like you, better human beings, better equipped, with better knowledge, and with better piety, but still human beings. They were not ma'asoom. Actually, there is no ma'asoom or innocent or infallible in Islam except Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everybody else, their words can be accepted or rejected. So fuqaha or fiqh, that's not divine. That's not eternal. That's not universal. That's where the ulama, they differed between themselves. That's where you've got different schools of thought. And sometimes the opinion and the fatwa are totally contradictory. So if it was divine, there would be no difference between the fuqaha. So therefore, fiqh is elastic, it's progressive, and it's also the product of the culture in which that scholar was living. So therefore, the statement of Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayh must be the reflection of the geopolitical situations which were happening at his time. You cannot pick up that fatwa and say, sitting in 21st century America, this is what is Islam. Am I clear? So therefore, this is the mistake Muslims need to know. When somebody takes literally the statement of an individual scholar and takes them as the word of Allah or the sole representation of Islamic Sharia, that person is making a mistake. This is the job which as Muslims we have to do. But at the same time, we have to understand that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the principles, He gave some of us, which we call the muhkamat, and the other is mutashabihat. وَالَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ مِنْهُ آيَاتٌ مُحْكَمَاتٌ هُنَّ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. So those principles which are one and one, two, so clear, cannot be compromised. But mutashabihat can be interpreted in more than one way. Also in the Sharia, you've got thawabit, constants, and you've got mutaghayyirat, which are variables. Constant will not change, but variables change with the passage of time to reply or to respond to different type of what environment and situation. And also in Islamic Sharia, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us ahkam tafsiliya, very detailed prescriptions. You cannot make 6 times salah. You cannot make 5 rakat in zuhr. All of those details are given by the Quran or by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But then the Quran has given us al-ahkam al-ijmaliyya, the generic principles. Do justice, be kind, do not kill, do not cheat, do not lie. So all of those things according to the time are going to be applicable. So these are the interpretations which are going to be the interpretation according to our culture, our need, our necessity. So therefore, those who take the generic principles of Islam and turn them into specifics, those who go literally with the statements of the fuqaha and present it as the sole Islamic interpretation, are those who take the mutashabihat, which are not even agreed upon among the scholars, or take the opinion of one scholar and say, this is what Islam is, are wrong among the Muslims. They are the ones who are bringing bad name to Islamic Sharia. And those who are really having this secularistic type of understanding and they want to get rid of Islam, they use them and they don't use the scholars or the 90% Muslims who say those people are wrong and look at the Quran, look at the Sunnah, look at the interpretations. They are totally against what ISIS and the rest of the people are doing. But because those people set into the agenda of the people who are against religion and Islam, so they present them as Muslims, and because 90% of Muslims who are peaceful and who love to coexist do not set in their agenda, so they do not want to portray them as true Islamic. They call them hypocrites or politically correct. So therefore, we have got the problem with both sides and we have to do our job. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect his religion and deen. Jazakumullah khair.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.